Hey everyone, welcome. It's so good that you can join us today. My name's Steve Fogg. I'm the online campus pastor here at Crossway. And this is Sam Farron. Sam, hello.
Hey Steve, good to see you.
Good to see you too.
And great to see you wherever you're watching from. It's an honor for me to be with you today. We've got an exciting service today, Steve.
We do. And yeah, if you're here for the first time or whatever you call Crossway home, it's really good to see you. Why don't you dive into the chat? Let us know where you're watching from. You know I like to do this every single week, but I love to hear from you. Wherever you're watching from in the world, whether it's Scotland, England, Europe, America, wherever it is, Sam, Australia, wherever. If you're from somewhere unique in Australia, we'd love to hear from you as well. Not just Melbourne, but anywhere else, because we have people from North Coast, New South Wales, Queensland, WA, Tassie, all kinds of places join us. So wherever you're watching from, it's a big welcome. Don't forget, you've got to dive in the chat, because I'll be in the chat in a couple of minutes to say hello to you.
Yeah, we're a friendly church, Steve. One of our Crossway values is there's room for you.
Yep.
And so don't be a stranger. Don't just sit there and watch today. Make sure you connect with the online chat host today. Jump in, say, hey, we want to get to know you. We don't just want to be interacting on the same screen together. We want to get to know you and who you are in the way that we're engaging with this service today. And we've got a really great service today, Steve. We've got a lot to look forward to. We've got an awesome, powerful, significant time of worship that we're believing is going to bless you wherever you find yourself, wherever you're watching from, whether you're sitting down or standing up or lying in bed, whether you got your breakfast or your dinner, whatever time of day it is, we've got an awesome time of worship. And we've got Pastor Dale back.
Whoa, great.
We got him back in action, back on the platform.
So cool.
It's going to be great. We're looking forward to hearing what he has to say to us today. So, get excited, get prepared for that. Plenty to look forward to in our service today.
That's right. And if you want to know more, if you want to find out more and get connected more into the community here at our online campus, you can join our Facebook group. It would be great to be able to meet you in person in our Facebook group. There's hundreds of us in the group, but it's very personal. We do daily devotions and we have good conversations in that group. And I'd love to be able to say hello to you in that group. So we'll pop the link in the chat. Even if you're watching this back, that's cool. You can click on the link and join our Facebook group.
What an awesome way to do life together, Steve. What an awesome way to connect with each other. We're just preparing for our time of worship today. And I wonder if you'd pray with me whilst we get ready to do that. We want to be preparing our hearts in this moment that God might speak to us through this time of worship and through connecting with his holy scriptures. So if you'd close your eyes and bow your heads or adopt your prayer position wherever you find yourself with me. I'll do the same and let's commit this time that we have together to God. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time and this moment and just the opportunity to set it aside today to hear from you, to worship you, and to focus on you. We pray that we would walk away today different because we chose to engage with you today, God. Yeah. We pray that we would walk away today changed and more connected to other people because we chose to engage with you today. For those of us that are sort of on the edge about whether we connect and reach out or not, God, I pray that by your Spirit, you'd encourage us to do that. You'd encourage us to step over to the edge, to reach out, to connect with people online, and to find an awesome space of community here at Crossway. And for Dale, as he brings the word, would it be inspired? Would it be of you? And might it change our hearts today? So we love you, God. We trust you with our hearts. And we pray that you would give us an awesome time together today in this service. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen. Amen. And again, I had a little bit of a forewarning of what Dale's going to speak about. So come prepared with that open heart, that open mind, and turn up the speakers for the worship. It's always good just to really get rid of the distractions, the extra phone on the couch, you know, that all that sort of stuff. But get ready to worship. Open your hearts and your minds to the Word of God as Dale comes and preaches to all of us. Mm. And, you know, it's going to be an incredible time. Mm. And again, I'll be in the chat in a couple of minutes.
Come on.
But let's join the team in the auditorium as we worship our God together with all our hearts, minds, soul, and strength.
Good morning, Crossway. Hope you're doing well. Good morning, everyone here and online as well. Why don't we stand and worship our God? Glorious. Six, shine, Jesus. Shine, Jesus. Shine for all the to see you, my glory.
Shine, Jesus. Shine for all the world to see you, my glory. Shine, Jesus.
Sing, there's a stream.
There's a stream in the desert, a river of life on the plains. The Lord is here. Right now, do you see it? The kingdom of heaven is near. The Lord is here.
Cross, they sing.
So sing, rejoice. Lift up the chorus of praise to the King and praise your voice. Behold, the Savior is doing a brand new thing. There's a hope, feel the rising. The shadow of all.
Yes, Lord, we worship you in this place this morning. Thank you for abounding love, glorious love, unconditional love. We lift our hearts and we sing to you this morning. Leave everything behind, but a worshipful heart for our Father. Oh, what an act confounding.
shine for your pure heart, the love of Christ in me. Show me agape as I receive. Lord, I will love you as you have loved me. Show me my neighbors and enemies, and I will love them as you have loved me.
Yes, Lord.
To love the Lord. This is your Lord and grace. So I will strive to be transformed in love with faith unfailing. Show me agape as I receive, Lord. So I will look to Jesus, who shows me how to be. Agape love is what will last for all eternity.
You give life.
You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord.
Oh, you're a great God. And we praise you, Lord, this day. And we thank you that it's you that has breathed life into each and every one of us right from the beginning. But then you went next level and you breathed your spirit into our lives. And for that, we are eternally grateful. And so, God, on the back of whatever we experienced this last week, I have a sense that many of us need to choose praise. It's an act of the will. In this moment, we choose to praise you over lament. We choose gratitude over complaint. We are so grateful for your love. We're grateful that you have given us your spirit. We're grateful for Jesus. We're grateful for this church. So many things that we are grateful for. And so we choose gratitude over complaint this morning, believing that you are walking with us through all of life's challenges. And in this moment, we're asking God that you might touch our hearts afresh. We anticipate that you will change us this morning. We don't pray that in a sense of entitlement. We pray it because we know that you love us. We know that you want to touch us. We know that you want to redirect our paths when we're going in the wrong direction. So God, this day we ask, would you come by your Spirit and move in and through our lives? For those of us in this room, for those of us online, we believe you're going to touch lives this morning and change us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, take a seat for those of you in the room. Great to have you with us. Turn around and say hi to someone. And online, why don't you say hi to your online host this morning? Good to have you with us. Well, it's always good to be in church, whether we are here in person, whether we are online. But if you are online, welcome to Crossway this morning. Good to have you with us, whether you're tuning in locally around Burwood East, whether you're a part of our regional areas, maybe nationally or even internationally. So good to have you with us. If you're watching live or whether you're watching through the week on demand, we trust that your experience of Crossway today will be very much an uplifting one, as it is for all of us. I'm sure it will be. I heard Pastor Dale's message last night. It's a ripper. And we continue along the lines of this David series. You can see behind me, we've got an overview of the 6 weeks we've had through these wonderfully crafted images here. Great pieces of art that Sarah Gunn, someone, a lady who's on our staff, has produced over the last few weeks. And so we're looking forward to lesson number 6 in our 10-week David series. It's been a good one, hasn't it? Hey, if you're here for the very first time, never been to Crossway before, and you are in the room, please don't rush off after the service. We have an area in our foyer. It's called the Next Steps area. It's clearly signed out there. You can't miss it. Come and meet with us after the service, and we'll field any questions you might have. We have a welcome pack for you too. So it'll be great to get to know you after the service. For those of you online, let your online host know that you're viewing for the very first time. We'd love to connect with you, not just today, but through the week as well. So that'd be good. Hey, another way we can connect into the life of the church is through our life groups. Pastor Bill, would you come and join me on stage? Put your hands together for Pastor Bill, our life groups pastor. Does a great job. How many years now, Bill, on staff? 9 years. And you've just got back from long service leave, so welcome back. Good to have you here. And so, Bill, life groups, well, we often say here in the church, one of our key values is there is room for you. You can step into authentic community, whoever you are and wherever you are. Now, one of those ways is through life groups. Tell us a little bit about that.
Group, and we find that just gives you a place that you can connect with other people. So we're actually running a 5-week taste and see, where maybe we've had a lot of people apply for groups and haven't been able to find the right fit. So if that's you, or if you're just new to Crossway and wanting to join in, we're running 5 weeks. It's from Monday the 15th of August, and we'll do it again in October. But that'll be both on online and in person. So there'll be some weeks online, some weeks in person.
So how do those online join that?
So with our online, they can have a purely online life group, and Pastor Steve will certainly guide them on that, so they can certainly engage with Pastor Steve on that one. But yeah, our life groups are the place where you can connect. So it's just an opportunity for people to taste and see. The commitment is 5 weeks, and then beyond that, maybe that group will continue on, or we can connect them into a group. It just gives a feel of what's it like to be in a life group.
Yeah.
And but life groups don't have to be complicated.
No.
You can find two friends and start meeting together. Do a Discovery Bible Method. Do a Going Deeper. So there's opportunities for us all to find two friends and connect. And that's as simple as that. Certainly my life group, we started around two of my daughter and two of her friends who went to a Thailand mission trip from the kids' space.
Yeah.
They went together, and that's how we started our life group, that we had three girls who all got along, so we as family said, hey, let's get together, and that's grown to seven families now.
Wow. So you don't need a Bible college degree to be a life group leader, do you?
You just need two friends. That's all you need. So no, it's not difficult. And there's many ways you can do it. You can do it in person. I know Pastor Dale and Pastor Eddie, they meet Friday nights online for 4 or 5 weeks of the year, and then they get together once every 4 or 5 weeks in person. So it doesn't have to be, there's commitment there,
sure,
but it's that joy of having someone that you can connect to, someone you can lean on, someone who can pray for you.
And a large church, that's important to actually build relationships with a group of people. Isn't it? In my life group, we're actually going away for the weekend in about 3 weeks' time. Just to sort of grow together in relationship.
That's a great way of getting to know each other a bit longer. A whole weekend together can be a good way of growing as a life group. There's no doubt about that.
Could go the other way too, couldn't
it? Yes.
Okay, Bill, over here. Let's unveil what we've got in the box. Because another way that you can contribute to the life of the church is through your life group. Often what our life groups do is pick a service project where we can give beyond ourselves and invest in our wider community. And one way we can do that is through our life care work. And I've put this little box together, highlighting a number of products here, because there is quite a need right now through our life care pantry. Now, what's happened over the last few months in particular is cost of living pressures have gone up. We are finding more and more people are presenting themselves to life care who are very much in need of staple products like these ones here. And so our cupboards are quite bare down there, a lot barer than what they were through the pandemic. And we absolutely need some replenishment of those. So what have we got here, Bill?
Well, it's basically just basic staples. And as you said, individuals, we can, when we go shopping, just grab an extra bag of rice.
Yeah.
Or as a life group, it would be great to sponsor and do this regularly, that we can all, when you come together, all bring something and bring it together, and we can start restocking our pantry on a long-term thing. Maybe you've stockpiled toilet paper over the pandemic.
Sure.
You don't know what to do at all. Great place to offload that. So yeah, certainly things that we need that'll last for a longer term to restock our pantry would be wonderful.
Vegemite, soap. I know the products I've got in here, I know these are the ones we desperately need of right now. Now, every week, if you go to our bulletin, you'll notice that there are a list of ingredients that are always listed there. They're the ones that we are desperately in need of. So whether you're in a life group or you're an individual or family, you can always look at that bulletin list each week, and then in your own shopping, just put a few of those items in and come and deliver them to our front area here where our life care donations arrive. So that'd be great for you to do that. And what we're after is not so much the one-off donations. They're helpful, absolutely. But we're after some regular champions, whether that be through a life group, individuals, families, that you would regularly donate some products to our life care pantry. So those who are in tough places can flourish through the work that we're doing there. And lives are being touched, let me assure you, through even practical work like this at life care. So good thing to be involved in, hey, Bill?
Fantastic.
Thank you, Bill.
Thank you, mate.
Appreciate your word this morning. And hey, before we ask Pastor Dale to come and give the word, I'm going to pray in a moment's time. Just before I do that, though, can I just address those of you online, our kids. Crossway Kids Online is ready to go. We've got a program designed just for you this morning. It's a ripper. So, hey, go along. Enjoy that, kids. We'll see you next week. And go well, won't you? I also want to acknowledge the offerings that you've all brought along with you either today or throughout the week. You've given electronically, or you'll give electronically this week. Thank you for that. Thank you for your faithful and consistent giving. It allows us to do the work that we do. It allows us to do things that Bill and I have just been chatting about as well. For those of you who are in the room and you'd like to physically give, just a reminder, we have secure boxes on the back wall. You can actually put your offerings into those secure boxes as you leave after the service. How about we pray together? Let's pray. Lord God, we're really grateful that we can be involved in a ministry like Life Care. And we want to pray that as each person that presents, or families that present in need during the week, that they would be blessed through these food packages and through the words that are spoken and the investment that we're making in people's lives that go well beyond the food itself. We are continually praying that lives will be transformed through the work of our pantry and our Life Care work there as well. So thank you, God, for what you're doing through all of that. I want to thank you too for the way you're transforming lives in a whole variety of ways across this church, your church. When we've seen over the last 3 weeks, over 20 people, 20 youth, young adults, and kids being baptized. For that, we are grateful, and we're praising you and celebrating that very fact. We pray that those 20 that have been baptized, that decision they've been made will be solidified in their heart. They'll continue to grow in their relationship with you. And for others who have made a commitment for baptism out of the last Alpha course and the recent youth camp, we pray that they will continue to move towards the baptism for them as well. And thank you for all that you're doing in that space. And God, we're also aware that this morning, our Brighton campus, our Mandarin service at 11:45 will begin for the very first time today. For that, we're celebrating. We're celebrating the lives that have been won to you through Mandarin Alpha there at Brighton over the last few weeks. And then here they are starting a service. So we pray your blessing upon the launch today for the leadership. And we're praying for genuine spiritual momentum over these next weeks as they kick off today. And again, God, we want to thank you for the opportunity to give to your mission here at Crossway. And so the giving that we have given back to you throughout this last week and the week to come, we pray will extend your kingdom and very much build your church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Pastor Dale, great to have you back after a period of leave and ministry. Good to see you.
Good on you, Mark. Thank you so much. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. It's great to see you. How exciting is that about Brighton, the Brighton campus? You know, it was only in January last year, so it's just a little bit more than 18 months ago, that they approached, because they really had their back against the wall, and there were about 25 people worshipping there. 18 months later, with a refreshed facility, and now as Crossway Brighton, there are roughly 70 people worshipping there on the weekend, and now we're about to plant a Mandarin congregation inside there, and you just that sense of positive spiritual momentum, people on the front foot, their faith is high, new people coming all the time, some people just starting to come to know Jesus, which is kind of new terrain for the church there over multiple years. That's worth celebrating, isn't it? I think it is. That's really good. Praise God for it. Boy, don't, come on, you can do a better celebration than that, but don't you? Save it, that's all right, no, save it. But we got to realize the things that's a big deal, it's really fantastic. Can I say it's great to be home? Thank you so much, and I want to thank you as a congregation and the leadership here, that we have it in our heart always to think beyond ourselves. And so while Edie and I had a couple of weeks annual leave, we also had a couple of weeks of ministry leave. That had us over in Europe and also in Singapore. And we had 3.5 weeks in Europe. The coolest day we had was 35 degrees. The hottest day we had was 40-ish. And maybe slightly higher than that. And so it was just plain straight up and down hot. But I had opportunity to speak in front of a global gathering of pastors, and also in Singapore. If you know the name, Pastor Edmund Chan, he organized for me to speak to a significant group of Singaporean pastors as well, and do some ministry there on the way back home. Been a very special time. And then just last Sunday, because we've been back for a fortnight, but just last Sunday, while Mark was preaching here, I spoke down at New Peninsula, where I was formerly the senior pastor. They were having a Thanksgiving service, and so I preached down there, and also gave a gospel appeal, and about a dozen people responded to the gospel. That's just preached. That's worth celebrating now. Come on. Yeah. It is. All of heaven celebrates, the Bible says, over one sinner who repents. And we need to make sure we've got it in our hearts that we kind of are aligned with what's taking place in the eternal realm. Okay, we're continuing with the David series today. And I just need to catch us up. Because historically, if you're not familiar with the Bible, we're roughly 1000 BC. And so we've already gone through the whole zone of kind of David coming through, David being spiritually anointed as the future king, all of the tussles he had to do with Saul. And so we hit this phase of his life now where he's become the king. Let's just kind of get some of the backdrop where it says, Ishbosheth, Saul's son, Saul's now deceased, as is Jonathan. Saul's son was 40 years old when he became king, and he ruled over Mahanaim for 2 years. Meanwhile, the people of Judah, which is down in the south, remained loyal to David. David made Hebron his capital, and he ruled as king of Judah, this southern area, for 7.5 years. Jumping forward in the narrative, that was the beginning of a long war between those who were loyal to Saul, even though he is deceased, and those loyal to David. As time passed, David became stronger and stronger, while Saul's dynasty became weaker and weaker. So it wasn't just like a neat and simple kind of handover period. There were years where this thing struggled. And now we hit here, 2 Samuel chapter 5, where it says David was 30 years old when he began to reign. Is that old enough? Of course it is. David was 30 years old when he began to reign. He reigned 40 years in all. He had reigned over Judah from Hebron for 7.5 years, and from Jerusalem he reigned over the entire United Kingdom of Israel and Judah for 33 years. So what do you do? You're the new king, and it had been coming for so long. It had been coming with so much opposition, both physical and spiritual, no doubt. And so what does David have in his heart? He has it in his heart to bring the Ark of God to Jerusalem, which is now the capital. It says, then David again gathered all the elite troops of Israel, 30,000 in all. So this is him kind of taking the cream of the military forces because he's going to bring the ark to Jerusalem. So he's doing it with no small amount of both security and pomp and ceremony. He led them to Bala of Judah to bring back the ark of God, which bears the name of the Lord of heaven's armies, who is enthroned between the cherubim. That's a visual representation of the ark overlaid with gold, the cherubim on the mercy seat. And it said that the very presence of God dwelt between the cherubim. Inside the ark were the two stone tablets written by the very finger of God given to Moses on Mount Sinai with the Ten Commandments. In the New Testament, in Hebrews, it also says in there was Aaron, the priest, Aaron's rod that budded, and also a jar of manna. But those two items are not referenced in the Old Testament like that as being in the ark. They placed the ark of God on a new cart. They brought it from Abinadab's house, which was on a hill. Uzzah and Ahio, Abinadab's sons, were guiding the ark that carried the ark of God. Ahio walked in front of the ark. David and all the people of Israel were celebrating before the Lord, singing songs, playing all kinds of musical instruments, lyres, harps, tambourines, castanets, and cymbals. They got the full worship team out. They got the military out. They got a new cart. They're making progress with God here. This is the ark coming back to Jerusalem. It's a high moment, isn't it? At a high point in David's life. He's the new, young king over the entire nation. And look what it says. But when they arrived at the threshing floor of Nacon, the oxen stumbled, and Uzzah, one of the sons of Abinadab, where the ark had been, Uzzah reached out his hand and steadied the ark of God. Maybe being concerned that it might have fallen off the ark, off the cart. Then the Lord's anger was aroused against Uzzah, and God struck him dead because of this. So Uzzah died right there beside the ark of God. David was angry because the Lord's anger had burst out against Uzzah. He named that place Perez Uzzah, which means to burst out against Uzzah, and still called that today. And now David was afraid of the Lord because he asked, how can I ever bring the ark of the Lord back into my care? So here is David's two responses. He's angry. He's afraid, and I'm going to combine the two of those and describe and just say David was disappointed. Now, let's be honest. We have all experienced disappointment with God. We have all experienced disappointment with God. It's that gap in expectation. Here's what we expected, and here's what was delivered, and that gap is called disappointment. I put up there 35 and 82 because I can remember a period in my life where a good mate, his wife, whose name was Heather, was diagnosed with cancer. It was a very serious diagnosis. Young married couple, three young children, loved Jesus, involved in Christian leadership. And Heather was doing a very serious struggle with cancer, and the medical prognosis was not good, but she really wanted to live. She was going to do everything she could. They were going to pray. They were going to seek healing. They were going to adjust their diets and lifestyle. Everything that could be done so that she could live. Now, simultaneously with that, they were friends. Simultaneously with that, I had a couple in my congregation. And John, who's 82, John got told he had a very bad and terminal, what the medical people said was a terminal case of cancer. And when Francis, John's wife, called me to tell me about it, they'd already been tracking it for months, but they called me because the oncologist had said to John and Francis, you probably need to get things in order because John maybe only has weeks. He's kind of in that final zone now. And so they called me up and to tell me on the phone. I said, oh, I'm so sorry to hear that. John, who is Dutch, they're both Dutch, John was pretty stoic about it. He goes, look, I'm 82. I love the Lord. I know where I'm going. I've lived a long and good life, and I'm not afraid to die. I said, yeah, but John, it's still really heavy news. No, I'm sorry to hear that. And I prayed with them. Well, week after week after week after week went by at church, And John, you know, you can be 82 and look like you're 60, or you can be 82 and look like you're 100. Well, John was the latter, and he had been for a long time. John was, you know, he was an old 82, but he just kept showing up at church. And so after about 6 or 7 weeks, the oncologist called him in and said, let's just test you again to see what's happening. So they tested John again, and then they called him at home, he and Francis, and said, you need to come and do another set of tests because something went wrong with the last set of tests. They did another set of tests, and the oncologist invited them into his office, put up John's old scans with very significant cancer in his body, put up his new scans, and the oncologist said, we cannot find any cancer in your body at all. Francis said, praise the Lord. And the oncologist said, well, you might as well praise him because we have no explanation for that whatsoever. John lived another 7 years till he was 89. That wasn't cancer that took him out. Just kind of more old age type stuff. Heather, so John was happy. John was happy to go and be with the Lord. He's 82. Heather, who really wanted to live, Heather passed away with cancer. I remember feeling really disappointed with God about that. I remember turning my disappointment into a prayer. And I said, God, if you're going to do like a wham, bam miracle, like shock and awe, how is that at all possible? Why didn't you do that for Heather? Like, come on, if you were God, you'd do a bit more of that, wouldn't you? Flex your muck, come on. You'd flex, you know, because you could. You're powerful. I've got a loose bit of skin on my lip. It's annoying me. There we go. You would. And I remember getting, and I was frustrated with God, and I'm like, why? Why John, and why not Heather? And see, there's the gap of my misunderstanding. There is the gap of me struggling to bow the knee and to surrender to the sovereign will of God because He is God and I am not. Thank God for that. Disappointment is the experience of sadness or displeasure caused by the non-fulfillment of one's hopes or expectations. That's disappointment. It's that zone. Pastor Tim Pierce some weeks ago said, if a vending machine doesn't give you what you ask for, it's broken. And some people think of God like a vending machine. Like, I prayed. Come on, just think about it. Yeah? How many times have you prayed and it didn't turn out? How many of you prayed for a loved one who ended up dying? How many of you believe that God directed you into that venture, but then it failed? Or you really prayed for a child. I had a young couple last night come to me and say they'd prayed and they'd sought God, but they were unable to become pregnant and they had felt disappointed in that zone. How many of you believe that God led you into your marriage, but then it ended in divorce? These very real experiences where life doesn't quite turn out the way that we'd ever set out and hoped and expected that it would set out. And let's just acknowledge collectively, none of us are guaranteed the red carpet treatment through life. I wasn't a Christian when my parents divorced, but if I was, I could have said, God, why did you let my mum and dad's marriage break up? Why did I go through some of the stuff that I went through? Because when we go into the hard spaces, why is a primary question that gets generated. I had a little boy come up to me at a social gathering once when he learned I was a pastor. I was sitting down, I remember it very well, and he walked up to me and he said, why did God let my daddy die? I said, mate, I said, God loves you and He loved your dad as well. And the little boy just disintegrated into tears. Answering the why question is beyond us when it's not easy to put the pieces together. We don't get to see the grand plan. We don't understand all the intricacies of life and this sovereign activity of God. And in that space, disappointment is not at all uncommon. This is a true statement from a person. I trusted, prayed, believed, and waited, and in the end, God did nothing but ignore my pain and suffering. I always grew up believing that God cared, but I've found out over the past several years, and here is their conclusion, that He doesn't. That's how they feel. God doesn't care. Isn't it challenging when your feelings are giving you one set of information and you're reading a different set of information in the Bible? The Bible says, cast your cares on the Lord, for He cares for you. But your feelings are telling you it feels like He doesn't care. You might be going through a zone and it's so tough and it feels like God hates you. And the Bible says God has demonstrated His love for you on this. While we're still sinners, Christ died for us. He's demonstrated His care. Your feelings might be saying, it feels like God's not paying attention to what's happening here. And Jesus said, there's not a sparrow that lands on the ground, but my Father knows about it. You're far more important than a sparrow. Jesus said, God knows the very number of hairs that are on your head. Your feelings might say, oh, God just feels like He's a million miles away. And the Bible says, draw near to God, for He will draw near to you. He is imminent. He is present. See, sometimes we need to tell our feelings what we know. I know certain things. Because our feelings, let's just acknowledge this, our feelings are free will agents. They'll go roaming around all over the place. And I need to say this very candidly. A feeling of disappointment is not a sin. A feeling of disappointment is not a sin. But can I say very candidly to you, to remain there and allow that to be the marinade over your life long term, you will never ever reach your full potential in God, in life, in relationships, in people, with work, whatever domain it might be. If you allow disappointment to be the narrative and the marinade over your life, you are not going to flourish in life with a narrative of profound disappointment perpetually resting on you. How, therefore, do we get unstuck? How do we get unstuck from our disappointment? It's a moment. It's real that it's a moment, and it's generated by one of these, if only God would have healed, if only God would have paid attention, if only God would have saved that relationship. And sometimes we direct it at ourselves as well. We're even disappointed with ourselves. If only I would have said this. I remember when a friend of mine took his own life, and he'd actually been reaching out to me, and I had so many if onlys after he committed suicide. Like, what else could I have done? If only I had gone around there that day. See, that these moments of disappointment are real, but it cannot afford to be the narrative of our life. And it's not unusual to have an if only. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if only You had been here. Remember, she had sent the message out to Jesus, and these people are friends with Jesus. Mary, Martha, Lazarus, He dined in their home when He was in the area. He was close to these people. They sent the message. Lazarus is really sick, and Jesus delayed His coming. If only You had been here. Now, N.T. Wright puts it this way. He said, if you're like Martha, if you have an if only in your heart and mind right now, put yourself in Martha's shoes. Run to meet Jesus. Tell Him the problem. Ask Him why He didn't come sooner and why He allowed the awful thing to happen. He's saying, come to Jesus with your if only. See, sometimes, let's just be candid. We don't know why something happened. But we need to come back to some bedrock statements at the point of our disappointment and tell our feelings what we know. I know I'm loved by God. The job fell through, the relationship fell through, the bad health report came, and it is going to happen. This is just part of the challenge. It is going to happen. And rather than going into the profound whys, which tend to be unanswerable, rather than going to the profound whys, it's a point to humbly submit and go back to what we know. I know I'm loved by God. I know He cares. I know He's here. Because character and faith development are ultimately developed in the fire. If God perpetually skirted us around, from Psalm 23, lo, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, and None of us really want to go through. We don't want to have to go through the fire, the water, the hard times. We don't have to go through the criticism, those who are reflecting negatively on our character or our activities, whatever. Like, but it was funny. Someone said to me outside just this morning, you know, standing outside in the cold with my jacket on, and they said, oh, you know, courageous thing to stand out in the cold. And I just jokingly said, this is the easy bit. This is the easy bit. Standing in the cold is nothing. Making the challenging call. And then taking kind of what comes with that. We all have to face this. The key to avoiding disappointment with God, therefore, is to surrender our wills to His and to submit and to align to His will. Especially, can I say, when things don't go as we expected. To simply acknowledge He is the sovereign King and we are not. And God, it feels all wrong. Like, it's fine. It's fine. It's even fine to acknowledge, I feel disappointed right now. That's not a sin. There's a gap that's been established. That's not the way I thought it was going to pan out. But God, I know You love me. And I know You're here. David wrote these words. Look how candid he is. Lord, how long will You forget me? Forever? How long will You look the other way? How long must I struggle with anguish in my soul, with sorrow in my heart? Every day? How long will my enemy have the upper hand? So he opens Psalm 13 like that. Look how he exits Psalm 13. But I trust in Your unfailing love. See how he's telling himself what he knows? See how he's flexing the muscle of faith, which is demonstrated in trust? I will rejoice, telling his feelings what is going to happen. I will rejoice because You have rescued me. I will sing to the Lord because He is good to me. And how important is it to be able to tell ourselves that at the moment of disappointment or in the zone of disappointment so we don't stay there? You know, I was praying with some of the intercessors before the service, and all of a sudden I had an image. I had not thought this image before, but I had this image just not so long ago. I was swinging my grandson on a swing. He's all buckled in. He's got a little seatbelt, so it allowed me to pull him back. And the higher the pullback, the greater the swing. And I feel like disappointment's a little bit like that. The greater the disappointment, at that moment of trust and faith and declaration to God about His goodness, the greater the rejoicing and the worship and the celebration and the praise. It's like there's a proportionality between the two of them. We read in Hebrews 12:11 that no discipline is enjoyable while it's happening. Not that all suffering is discipline, by the way, but it is certainly the framework of character formation. It's painful, but afterwards there will be a peaceful harvest of right living for those who are trained in this way. So at this high point of celebration and praise and new cart and bringing the oxen to Jerusalem, and then Uzzah gets struck down by God Himself, David decided to move the Ark of the Lord, decided not to move the Ark of the Lord into the city of David. Instead, he took it to the house of Obed-Edom in Gath. The Ark of the Lord remained there at Obed-Edom's house for 3 months. And the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and his entire household. So David, let's just acknowledge what happens here. He hits the pause button. When things don't turn out, sometimes it's important to hit the pause button and just to try and catch what's God saying. But there's a profound difference between hitting the pause button and clarifying what's God saying and therefore what am I going to do about it. There's a profound difference between that and getting stuck in disappointment. You don't want to have disappointment as the narrative over your life. Now, this same story of the Ark being brought to Jerusalem is also captured in 1 Chronicles. And there's a little statement in 1 Chronicles 15 that doesn't happen over in our text from 2 Samuel. And it says this, David speaking, because you Levites did not carry the Ark the first time, the anger of the Lord our God burst out against us. We failed to ask God, say the word with me, how. We failed to ask God, how to move it properly. Now, it was documented in the law of Moses that David should have been familiar with, that it was only the Levites who were to be on the poles. We're not talking new oxen and new carts. It's Levites who are to carry. And David was potentially getting a little loose around the edges. He was already at this stage taking multiple wives, even though it says in his scriptures that the king should be the husband of one wife. It overtly says that specifically about a king. And while the kings of the nations, because of their power and their wealth and their authority, they could have, and it was normal for kings to have so many wives, whole harems. And David went in that direction. He ignored the word of God with regard to the wives, and it appears he ignored the word of God with regards to who's supposed to be carrying the ark. And he has this little moment of sober reflection about how he was doing what he was doing. So going back to our text, that David has done the review on how he should proceed. So he starts to move forward distinctly now. 2 Samuel 6. Then King David was told, the Lord has blessed Obed-Edom's household and everything he has because of the ark of God. So David went there. Just quick point here. He went there. Sometimes you've got to go there, meaning sometimes you've actually got to go back before you can go forward. Sometimes you've actually got to go back to it. I actually wrote an email to somebody who's not happy with me about a month ago. They came back. They sent me a very long email. And so I reached out again this week saying, come on, let's catch up. Sometimes you've got to go back before you can go forward. You've got to go there. So David went there and brought the Ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with great celebration. After the men who are carrying the Ark of the Lord had gone six steps, David sacrificed a bull and a fattened calf. That is new. And David danced before the Lord with all his might, wearing a priestly garment. Quick footnote, if you go to the passage, I'm not going to pause here, but he danced so vigorously in this priestly garment, and this progress with sacrifice and with praise, that one of his wives, Michal, mocked him when he came home that day. And then it just says in the text, she never had a baby. As a result. And it doesn't say that God caused her not to have a baby. It just says she never had a baby. And I simply would put the little footnote in there. It's not a good idea to be critical of your husband or your wife's worship style. That's not the main point of today's message, though. And so David and all the people of Israel brought up the Ark of the Lord with shouts of joy and with the blowing of ram's horns. So progress is now made based on sacrifice and praise. Now, quick word to anybody who feels like they're stuck in disappointment. Progress is made on sacrifice, that is, the sacrifice of Jesus, the shed blood of Jesus. If you've found yourself stuck in disappointment, just realize Jesus shed his blood for you. God has demonstrated his love for you in this while you're a sinner, not at your high point, not at your best. While you are still a sinner, Christ died for you. And every forward step you take is under the shed blood of Jesus. We do not need to rely, as it says in Hebrews, on the shed blood of bulls and calves and goats, etc., but on the singular sacrifice of the Lord Jesus. And progress was made every six steps, it says. There's the shedding of blood, and there was great praise and worship and celebration. Your progress out of being marinated in disappointment is connected to the shed blood of Jesus and the testimony of your mouth. Your willingness to bring a sacrifice of praise and of thanksgiving to the living God, who does love you and who is good, who is near and who is for you, even though all of your feelings are saying the exact opposite. So let's have a look. Let's kind of do a quick recap. How do we move from being stuck in disappointment? What have we said? We said disappointment should be a moment, not a destination. And if you've gone there like as a destination and you're stuck, it's like you're spinning your wheels like a bogged car and you're not sure what to do, let's just acknowledge you're not supposed to stay there. It's not a sin to feel disappointed, but it's not supposed to be a destination. Secondly, come to God and ask Him how to proceed. How? How am I supposed to step forward from this zone? Be sensitive to what He's saying. It's discipleship 101. What does God say and what am I going to do about it? Ask God how you're supposed to proceed. Thirdly, you might have to go back before you can go forward. There might be a level of non-resolution that you actually need to engage with. You might have to go back before you go forward, but it's actually still progress away from stuck. And then ultimately, your progress will be based on sacrifice and praise. Stand in the very presence of the God who shed His blood for you and praise Him. And ultimately, this attitude of heart for us is surrender, it's submit, and it's align. And rather than perpetually wanting to hold on and claim your rights, rather than shaking your fist in the face of God saying it's not fair and you didn't deliver and you said and it should have been like this and this is what I believed, rather come to a point of humbly surrendering yourself and acknowledging you are God and I am not. And I submit myself to you and I will align to your will. And then step forward with sacrifice and praise. What do you think? How about we pray together? Father in heaven, right now I want to quite specifically pray for those who feel like today's message has been very uniquely, it might even feel exclusively for them, who feel like they've been ushered into a zone and they feel stuck and they never would have chosen to be there, but they're not quite sure how to get out of there. So Father in heaven, I want to say thank you for your profound reminder of the pathway out of being stuck, the pathway out of kind of being marinated in disappointment with you. That's actually possible for a life to flourish afresh as we humbly present ourselves to you. So I want to pray, moved by your Holy Spirit, in power to set the captives free and to heal the brokenhearted and to give sight to those who are blind, who've been blind to the fact that there was a way forward for them. So I lift each one up to you right now. And I want to pray quite specifically to anyone who's here or anyone who's online. And honestly, this has been the framework of your rejection of God because you've been disappointed with Him. And I say to you right now, He knows you. He loves you. And He is for you. He's demonstrated it all in Jesus. And your life does not have to carry the perpetual narrative of disappointment. But He invites you forward. In fact, He invites you right now to put your trust in Him. It might be that you're putting your trust in Him again because you feel like trust was broken. Or it might be for the very first time that you're putting your trust in Jesus and you're saying, what you did there, that profound love, a demonstration of love for me and the judgment of my sin, you paid a price for me. So right now, I'm putting my trust in you. And if that's you right now, you might even want to pray a prayer in your heart where you say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God, you love me and you are for me. And God, while I don't entirely understand why some things have happened, I just want to affirm afresh my trust in you. If you've never put your trust in Jesus before, put your trust in Jesus right now. Say, thank you, you died, you gave your very life for me, and I put my trust in you right now. Father, come in power, the power of your Holy Spirit, to each one who reaches out to you in faith right now. And I pray today would be a great day of liberation. I pray that today would be a great day where lives afresh are stood up, washed down, cleaned up, put back on the tracks, where we hear afresh what you want us to do. What is God saying? What am I going to do about it? Father, help us to walk forward out of being stuck in disappointment to a life that celebrates you in glory and honor and praise because you are good. Come on, everyone. Let's stand on our feet and let's worship this great King because he's worthy of all our worship. Let's stand up and let's bless and praise his name. Thank you, Dad.
Why don't we finish the celebration? Glorious.
Glorious. Shout it out in glorious. Make it louder. Jesus, we shout your name. Jesus, we make your praise. Glorious. You are glorious. God, you are glorious.
And my God.
My God, you reign forever and ever. Your name, your love remains forever and ever. You stay the same.
Shout it out,
shout it out, shout it out. If you know he's good, sing it out, for the Lord is good. Shout it out loud, you are glorious.
Good. We began the service shouting out our praises, and we end the service shouting out our praises. And we've been reminded this morning that that is a good thing to do. We need to shout out our praises because praise is an antidote to those challenges we'll experience in life and those disappointments we have with God. It's a good thing. It helps us progress ourselves forward. And you might need that reminder as you go into this week. Remember to tell your feelings what you know. And what we do know is this: you are loved by God. You are seen by God. You are heard by God. You are cared for by God. For all of us, and those of you online, hear those words, won't you? You are loved by God. He hears you, he sees you, he cares for you. Let's take that very premise and that truth into our week ahead. Thank you, Pastor Dale, for that word. It's a beauty. Thank you. Hey, put your hands together and just thank him very much. Great to have you back on stage and in the room. Online, it's been great to connect with you, and I trust that you've had that uplifting experience that I promised that it would be right at the beginning of this service. God has moved, and we always anticipate that, don't we, in our lives. So thank you for being with us. Make sure you connect with your online host there if you would like prayer. That's available for you. We'd like to connect with you through the week. We'd like to pray with you and for you as well. For those of you who are in the room, our prayer team with Pastor Scott will be here in a moment's time to receive you. I know many of you have already done business with God this morning as Pastor Dale prayed. That's a good thing. We want to acknowledge that. Others of you might value some extra prayer down the front here as you deal with those disappointments that you're challenged with in life right now. So please come and receive prayer. There's great power in prayer. Great to be worshiping with you this morning, and we look forward to seeing you next week. Good on you. God bless.
That was an incredible message from Pastor Dale. Incredible time of worship. And if you're here today and you said yes to Jesus, we just want to celebrate with you. We want to be able to cheer you on.
Come on.
Maybe you moved from that disappointment with God to a fully fledged worshiper, or maybe you're just not even sure yet, but that's okay. We're here for you. We want to be able to connect with you and just celebrate with you, but for you to be able to reach out to us. And there are a couple of ways to do that, right, Sam?
Yeah, 100%. We'd so encourage you to take that faith step and to go, yeah, something happened for me in my spirit today, and so I'm going to take an action step. And we'd love for you to choose to connect in the chat and choose to respond and say, yeah, that was me. Make yourself known to our chat host today. We've got a link that you can click on there, head straight to that and say, yeah, today for me, I chose to follow Jesus and turn towards that fully fledged worshiper in Christ. Or maybe it's prayer. Maybe there's something on your heart that you'd love for someone to partner with you in prayer for. You can click on the link for that as well. Head straight there. Or perhaps if it's not that, it's community, and you'd love to find some community within the space that you find yourself, head to our Facebook group. Again, you can reach out in the chat. You'll be given the link to join our Facebook group. What a valuable way to connect in with community. So there's a couple of ways for you to respond there, but encourage you. If that's something that's on your spirit there, take that step. You know what that's the right. Spirit's prompting you to. Encourage you to really lean into that today.
That's right. That's right. And don't just be passive, right? Take that step. We want you to take that step. I hope that's coming through loud and clear. Wherever you are in your discipleship journey with Jesus, we just want you to take the step. And even if you're watching this back, even if you're not live with us, take the step. We are here for you. This is the only reason why we're doing this. So we want you to become a disciple of Jesus that multiplies. So if that's you, we celebrate with you. We've come to the end of the service, but we're just so pumped that so many people are responding to Christ. So many people are taking those steps of faith. And I hope that you can join us again this week. But until then, go in peace.